In fact, the public's appetite for heart-rending hits seemed insatiable, and no one benefited more than REO Speedwagon. Hard rock vets who took a chance on a piano ballad after a decade of dues paying.
When I played that Keep on Loving You for everyone, they thought I was nuts. For REO Speedwagon to play a piano ballad was just, I mean, it was unheard of.
But the tune got a crushing embrace from the fans. Led by Keep on Loving You, REO Speedwagon's High Infidelity became the best-selling album of 1981. Opening the door to a flood of power ballads.
You just felt it. You felt it like people were behind us. And it was a great, great feeling.
I don't wanna sleep. I just wanna keep on loving you.
People loved that music. They were fun and flashy and kind of silly, but they made people happy. REO Speedwagon, Journey, Styx, all these bands still tour amphitheaters, and they outsell a lot of bands that have big hits right now. They won't die. They're like vampires of pop.
Next, the Police lead a breakout.
And it was like really trying to create a new kind of music.
And later, a heavy metal makeover kicks off the decade of excess.
And that's why I got in the business in the first place, you know, is for free booze and chicks.
When Behind the Music continues.
Tonight's the night we'll make history. Honey.
It was an era when power pop was at its pinnacle. But even as Styx and REO Speedwagon were packing stadiums, rock seemed to be losing its ability to capture the public's imagination.
These are the best
I've done. 81 seemed to be a year of a decline in excitement, enthusiasm. Music was no longer the A passion of our audience.
In 1981, people were as likely to be playing Pac-Man as pop music.
I got a pocket full of quarters and I'm headed to the arcade.
As video games exploded in popularity, $5 billion were spent in arcades. While on the flip side, the record industry sold 55 million fewer albums than it had in 1980.
'Cause I got Pac-Man fever.
Pac-Man fever. Seems silly not to say, but video arcades and video games were a real threat. What kind of sales a loss when some kid drops 15 bucks in a machine? 10 of it could have been ours.
With sales declining and costs increasing, major labels had to sell 200,000 copies of an album just to break even, leaving many new acts out in the cold.
It's when it really started to change about, you know, you nurture an artist and you build an artist. It was just down to which was going to give you a quick buck.
No one was better at turning rock into royalties than the Rolling Stones. After releasing the smash album Tattoo You, the one-time street-fighting man hit the road for the year's most successful tour. But by taking on a corporate backer, some saw the Stones making a final farewell to their rebellious roots.
The Rolling Stones took on the first corporate sponsorship. They were sponsored by Jovan Perfume. And I think that definitely alienated some fans.
It was sort of an era where rock and roll had seeked to be an artistic endeavor and become increasingly sort of a big business venture.
Like rock itself, radio was at a turning point in 81, with passion taking a backseat to profits. Programmers ushered out the era of album-oriented rock in favor of scientifically engineered hit parades.
By 1981, radio had become the province of national programming consultants. Those guys should have been the pallbearers at radio's grave because they did a lot to kill interesting rock radio in the United States and left us with top 40 or nothing.
We wanted a format where you knew every artist. You get that art and that formula working together, and that's when the magic happens.
Lee Abrams was one of several consultants who transformed radio, creating programming philosophies through focus groups and telephone surveys.
I'm lying alone with my head on the phone.
We would have these little lines, rate them 1 to 10, these guys suck, don't ever play that song again, or play more of this.
In one sense, the tune testing worked. Abrams had 80 radio stations as clients, and all saw their listeners and profits increase dramatically. But the more radio play was sucked up by groups like Air Supply, the less opportunity disc jockeys had to explore edgier fare and expose new artists.
I'm all out of love. I'm so lost without you. I know you were right, believing for so long.
I was handed a playlist. I really had no choice in what I would play because they couldn't afford to have even one little moment where somebody would think, I'm not totally into this song.
Disc jockeys thought they were more important than the music. This really got all that BS out of the way. Here's what America likes.
And I feel like a number.
By 1981, nearly half of all American radio stations used consultants. Many more mimicked their methods, leaving some lamenting the loss of experimentation that had once defined rock and roll radio.
Feel like just another smoking.
Abrams credited with founding the format that killed radio. You minimize the risk. You play the sure shots.
It's just completely absurd. Out of every 100 people you talked to, 20% thought we sucked. Then at 80% that would just say, man, you guys are the greatest. Play more Journey.
In radio's increasingly corporate culture, bands like The Clash were left gasping for air. Their album, Sandinista, was a sonic salute to the rebels who had taken control of Nicaragua in 1979. But the music was about as welcome on American airwaves as Fidel Castro was in the White House.
But now this sound is brave and wants to be free.
Clash were one of the only true political bands at the time. That's what was so dangerous about them. He took a stand on world affairs.
I can imagine them sitting in Madison Avenue somewhere or who knows where, going like, what is this, you know?
Radio stations were very nervous about playing it. They're afraid of it. It came this wild, angry rock. It got ridiculous, the narrowness.
Radio was so unlikely to feature the unfamiliar that new music trends risked going entirely ignored.
There was a undercurrent that came out of punk rock, became new wave. It was bubbling under. It was starting to surface.
No one represented the promise and peril of New Wave better than the Police. For years, the British band had fused reggae, rock, and the striking voice of a man called Sting to produce an arresting sound.
Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light.
We just adopted that style of going, alternating from rock and roll to reggae. It appealed to me.
We were very intent, very focused on really trying to create a new kind of music.
They were already a huge hit in England, but for years the Police felt barred from American radio. Stations seemed unimpressed with their innovative sound.
We were still trying to get the radio to pay attention. It was almost impossible.
But the Police busted out with their third album, Zenyatta Mandata. Upbeat and approachable, it became a smash in the spring of 81. A rare success story for a band with an unfamiliar beat.
You can't get on the radio, then you don't really have much of a hope of really making the big time. We somehow slipped through a chink in the armor and got on.
The Police had breached the walls of rock and roll radio, and new wave music had only begun to crest. Other artists were waiting for a venue to showcase their music, and they were about to get one. Next, tunes on television turned the industry upside down.
You were the first one.
Video killed the radio star.
Everyone said, it'll never work. Nobody will ever watch videos.
And later, music gets a feminine curve.
I had gone to see the Go-Go's. I remember seeing them and thinking, this is so cool.
When Behind the Music continues.